I am very honored to rise virtually in this House to debate this motion from the Conservative opposition. I am always very pleased to discuss Canada's most important trading partner. As Parliamentary Secretary for International Trade, our relationship with our neighbors to the south is obviously of the utmost importance to me. So let's start with the numbers. And make no mistake, these numbers tell a very compelling story. We do over $2 billion in daily cross-border trade. Canada is the number one export market for the majority of the American states. In 2019, in fact, Canada was the number one customer for 32 different U.S. states. Over 74% of Canada's goods exports are sold to the United States. The U.S. is the single greatest investor in Canada. In 2019, U.S. stock investment in Canada was $455 billion, representing nearly half of all our foreign investment. But you see, when it comes to describing the importance of the relationship between Canada and the U.S., a purely economic analysis doesn't give you the full picture. Let me take you back, Mr. Speaker, to a day 20 years ago. Let me take you back to September 11th, 2001, to the day that two planes crashed into the World Trade Center and another hit the Pentagon. At that time, as you can imagine, many, many other planes were in flight during the terrible attack, planes en route to the United States, families returning from vacation, businessmen and women, students, Americans going home. But the Federal Aviation Administration closed U.S. airspace. In a phone call, Transportation Secretary Norman Mineta ordered, "Get those goddamn planes down." And so these planes and their passengers bound for the United States needed a place to go. They came to Canada, Mr. Speaker. On September 11th, 2001, 6,595 passengers and crew from 38 flights landed in the small town of Gander, Newfoundland. The story of the people of Gander opening their hearts and their homes to Americans is well known. It even spawned a highly successful Broadway musical, Come From Away. It is, for me, the story of the Canada-U.S. relationship. When Americans Clark and Roxanne Lauper and their young adopted child were wandering through the local Lions Club, which was housing airline passengers, a Gander resident they had never met before asked if the couple needed a shower and a place to sleep. "But there are no showers at the Lions Club," the American said. "No, no, you can come over to my house and shower," said the Canadian. When Lisa Zale and her American business associate, Sarah Wood, went to Canadian Tire for supplies and got to the cash to pay, the cashier asked if they were from one of the planes. When they nodded, the Canadian Tire employee said that anything that stranded passengers needed, they could take. The store was happy to provide it for free. Local pharmacists supplied medicine to passengers who needed it. Canadian teenagers saw the many young children confused and scared and organized a large party complete with games and cakes and costumes just to make them feel welcome and safe. I could go on and on, Mr. Speaker. It is the story of Gander, Newfoundland. It is one of the many Canadian stories of 9/11. And for me, it is the story of the Canada-U.S. relationship. Before I go any further, I would like to take this opportunity to congratulate President Joe Biden and Vice President Kamala Harris on their historic victory. This is certainly a new chapter in our relationship, an exciting one, full of promise and of hope. Vice President Harris spent her teenage years just on the other side of this mountain, on the other side of the border from my riding here in Montreal. I met President Biden when he came to Ottawa for a state dinner as then vice president in the Obama administration. Alors, je ne vais pas vous cacher, Monsieur le Président, l'optimisme que je ressens en ce moment. Soyons honnêtes, les quatre dernières années n'ont pas été de tout repos. Entre l'imposition de tarifs illégaux et injustifiés, le délaissement d'institutions internationales, le recul sur la protection de l'environnement et un manque constant de prévisibilité, cette relation si unique entre nos deux pays a été testée. Mais la force de nos liens, la force des relations entre Canadiens et Américains et le travail acharné de ce gouvernement pour préserver et protéger cette relation ont porté leurs fruits. Nous nous sommes debout, Monsieur le Président. Nous nous sommes tenus debout pour nos travailleurs, pour nos industries de l'aluminium et de l'acier, contre le protectionnisme et pour le multilatéralisme. All this at a time when the opposition was urging us to make compromises and to make sure that nobody would get too upset. The current leader of the official opposition even suggested in 2008 that Canada should abandon its countermeasures in response to U.S. tariffs because, and I quote, they are not worth the symbolic nature. There was nothing symbolic about our determination, Mr. Speaker, and the U.S. lifting their tariffs proved it. The motion before us today proposes the creation of a special committee tasked with studying all aspects of the economic relationship between Canada and the United States. While I'm not personally convinced that a new committee is necessarily required to achieve that goal, I do welcome any opportunity for parliamentarians to further examine this important relationship. I've already had the privilege to study the importance of our trading relationship with the U.S. at our International Trade Committee when we examined the new NAFTA, or the CUSMA agreement. We spent over 35 hours of intense study and heard testimony from witnesses during committee from an innumerable number of industries and sectors, and they each explained to us how closely our two economies were bound together. Nous avons entendu des fabricants automobiles, des producteurs laitiers, des manufacturiers, des syndicats, des représentants des Premières Nations, des producteurs de canola, de l'industrie chimique, des engraisseurs de bovins, de l'industrie musicale, des chambres de commerce, et j'en passe, Monsieur le Président. Nous avons pu voir directement l'impact de cette relation avec les États-Unis sur tous les secteurs et toutes les régions de notre pays. Je pense, par exemple, au maire de Windsor, Drew Dilkins, qui, dans son témoignage devant le comité, nous parlait des plus de 8000 personnes dans sa ville qui se rendent quotidiennement aux États-Unis pour travailler. Il nous a expliqué que les pièces d'une voiture fabriquée au Canada traversent la frontière en moyenne sept fois avant de sortir de la chaîne de production. Quel exemple parlant de l'intégration étroite de nos économies. La CEUM est une victoire, Monsieur le Président. C'est une victoire pour notre industrie de l'aluminium avec la levée de tout tarif et une nouvelle garantie de 70 % d'aluminium nord-américain dans la production de voitures contre 0 % auparavant. C'est aussi une victoire pour nos industries culturelles qui représentent plus de 53 milliards de dollars par an avec la préservation de l'exemption culturelle. C'est plus de 75 000 emplois protégés au Québec seulement. Il inclut un nouveau chapitre sur l'environnement qui veille à la qualité de l'air et qui lutte contre la pollution. Mr. Speaker, Canada and the United States enjoy one of the most productive, collaborative, and mutually beneficial bilateral relationships in the world. It is not only our business community that feels this way, but all Canadians. From Gander, Newfoundland, where so many literally open their homes, to here in Montreal and the eastern townships in Quebec, where so many Americans vacation, to Windsor, Ontario, where our respective auto industries intersect, right across to Calgary, Alberta, and Vancouver, British Columbia, where so many of our exports to the United States flow from. We are stronger together, Mr. Speaker, and our two countries share so much more than the most deeply integrated economies. We share a set of values, a common shared set of values of democracy, of freedom, of human rights, and a deep and strong North American culture. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.